Okay. Now we start regarding operating system, right? Now before that we need to know what are softwares. Okay. Now what are softwares? That is a very fundamental thing whenever you are operating a computer or any kind of gadget, electronic gadget. It may be your mobile device or it may be your computer or it may be your pager or whatever it may be. So the fundamental thing required for operating are, number one, is the hardware components and the software components. Now forget about the hardware components, coming to the software components. Now what are the software? Now generally what happens, now softwares are coded. Coded in the sense, some programming languages are used in order to build a software, right? The programming languages may be your Java, maybe your .NET, maybe your CSS, your other kind of things may be there, okay? So these are the programming languages used to code the software. That means why you require software? Because in your fundamental classes of the computer, you know that the computer is a dump machine. That means it will not do anything from its own. You need to train it, or you need to give some instruction to it so as to perform it according to your requirement, right? Now for that purpose, we need the software. Now in generally, we can define a software or a computer software, essentially a typical type of program which enables the users to perform some particular or the specific task or actually used to operate their computers. That means if you have a bunch of hardware, you could not operate it, right? Now let's take a small example of your television. Now earlier you have the CRT, that means cathode ray tube television, that is a big size television. Now currently you see your household televisions like your plasma TV, your LED TV, your LCD TV. Now currently it is the Android operating system enabled TV. Now you just find out the difference why that thing happened. Because as a general person, when I'm sitting at my home and I want to use my internet through a big screen, and that big screen should be some software enabled in order to use the internet, right? And that screen should have the hardware support. Okay. Now the hardware and the software, when combined together, it gives us the proper output, right? Now comes to the types of the software. What are the different types of the software? So softwares may be classified as three types. Number one is the system software. Number one is the application software. And number three is the utility software. Now what are system software, application software, and utility software? Now system software gives you the basic platform to use the machine, right? Machine in the sense the electronic gadget, right? Now these type of software are the basic or fundamental requirement whenever you are running a computer or whenever what type of gadget you are using. Now what are the application software? Now those application softwares are basically used to perform certain kind of tasks. For example, let's say you want to do some photographic edit on your computer. Now for that, you need any kind of application. It may be the Adobe Photoshop. Now what you do, you just install that Adobe Photoshop on your computer and edit the photograph by using that, right? Without Adobe Photoshop, your computer will work, but without the operating system. Now the system software, under the system software, it comes from operating system, right? Now without the operating system, your computer will not work, but without the Adobe Photoshop, your computer will work. That means in an other way, we can say that the basic requirement to operate a computer is the system software, right? Now coming to the third category, which is the utility software. So what is that? Utility software may be just like your antivirus kind of thing or firewall kind of thing. Now, whenever you are using internet or whenever you are doing something over internet through your gadget, Now, safety features must be there. Now, for the safety features, currently lots of antivirus softwares are available in the market. You just install that and use your computer in any tension. Without any tension, you are using that because you know that if I am installing the antivirus, nothing will happen to my system, right? So that's why we consider it as utility software. But on the bigger note, we can say that the application and the utility can be considered as the single type, right? Okay, one thing I am requesting all of you, if anybody has any doubt, please write something in comment so that I can elaborate it in a bigger manner, right? Now, next slide gives us regarding the operating system. Now, previous slide gives us the idea that the operating system is a category of the system software, right? Now, if it is a type of system software, now how could we operate it? Now, look at the diagram on your screen present in the right side of part. Now, as an end user of the computer, as a common people, we are the end user of the computer, and as the human user, that is the end user actually operates the computer, right? Generally, what happens, we do not know what's inside the computer, how the computer is operating, we do not know anything. But this gives us a basic idea how the computer is being operated, right? Now, for the operation of the computer, look at the second step. Here is the application software is there, right? And before that, the user first assesses the operating system. Without assessing the operating system, it is very difficult to assess the application software, because whenever you are booting your computer, that means your computer starts the operating system, and the operating system tries to find out what are the peripheral devices connected to your computer or not connected to your computer. If connected, then it will work properly, and if not connected, it will not work properly. Okay. Now, if somebody used the older version of Windows, just like Windows NT or Windows ME, then they will find if you have a mouse joined on your computer, you just do one thing, just unplug the mouse, switch on your computer, then plug in your mouse, then you will find your mouse will not work, right? But in the newer version, that means Windows 7, Windows 8, right? The newer version, it will automatically work because the operating system is being intelligent to identify the peripheral devices at once whenever it is joined. But the Windows previous versions, just like ME or HP, they do not allow the peripheral devices after the booting. Now, again, you reboot your computer in order to identify those particular peripheral devices, right? Now, coming to our topic, our application software and operating system. Now, you open the operating system after you open the application software. Now, after the operating system opened, then you can have the other system softwares. Other system softwares may be associated with the operating system. Then those are associated with the hardware, right? Now, for the example, let's somebody's computer has a graphics card, right? Now, if I have a graphics card, that means my operating system should read that graphics card and let me know that a graphics card has been installed in your computer, so you can use a high type of gaming software or whatever it may be, you can use that. So for that reason, the hardware is your graphics card, and the other type of, that means the other software can be act like a bridge between the graphics card to the operating system and let the user know that a graphics card has been installed in the computer, right? And it allows you to use that, okay? Now, an operating system is a system software that manages the computer hardware and software resources and provides the common service for the computer program. That means, the other way we can say that the operating system is act like a bridge in between the user and the computer hardware. Now, the application programs usually require an operating system to function, what I previously told you. And the operating system is basically an intermediary agent between the user and the computer hardware. Right? Now, these are the basic things you need to know whenever you operate a computer. Now, before that, just think of the situation. You are using a computer and suddenly something wrong happened to your computer. What you will do? You just try to troubleshoot your computer. Troubleshoot in the sense, let's say your computer, you are using internet and internet is not coming properly. Now, what will happen? You say that on other devices internet is coming, but my computer, it is not coming. That means there must be some problem within our computer. So what you do? You just go to the internet settings, and inside the setting, you just set your IP addresses and set the different kind of enable or disable thing of your software so as to from your you can access the internet. Now, this kind of basic thing you can come across whenever you are using any kind of devices or electronic gadgets. So basic thing you know to how to troubleshoot your computer if some error occurs. Now, classification of operating system. Now, basically, we classify the operating system in broadly four categories, that is multi-user, multi-processing, multitasking, and multi-thread. Okay. Now, multi-user means allows two or more users to run a program at the same time. Now, how could you experience that? In the multi kind of operating system, whenever you are using, just take an example, today's phones are like that kind of multi-user kind of operating system, some kind of phones are coming. What happens? You can do two different things in the same computer or same device. Right? Now that is a multi-user. That means more than one user can access that. Right? And it can be just take an example of your server. Right? Let's say you are using a Google server, and Google server means you are using your Gmail. It may be the Gmail, it may be the Google Drive, it may be the YouTube, whatever it may be. And it is always accessed through the Google server. Now you can say that a Google server is being accessed by multiple users at the same time. So that can be a simple example how a multi-user operating system can work. Now, multi-processing operating system, how could it be defined? Now, it supports running a program on more than one CPU. Achha, one CPU. CPU, you know, in the previous class, sir has told you that CPU stands for the central processing unit. And basically, whenever we consider the CPU, means it is the processor, right? A processor, that means you currently i5, different generation of i5, i7, different generation of i7, i3, different generation of i3. Though they are generally considered as the CPU. Okay. That means in a single system, multiple CPUs are connected, and that CPUs can run different programs in a same time. Right? For example, let's say three people are sitting in a system and they three are trying to solve three different kind of puzzles. Right? Suppose someone trying to solve the Sudoku puzzle, someone trying to solve the Rubik's Cube puzzle, okay, and someone trying to solve any kind of puzzle. Now, they have a single computer. What they do? They just do they just give the different tasks to the different CPU, and that different CPU provides the output of the different puzzles in the same time. So that's why it is called as multiprocessing. That means in a single time or a single interface time, the CPU can perform different kind of tasks. That means the CPU a single CPU could not perform a multiple task, but multiple CPU can perform a multiple task, right? Now coming to the multitasking, it allows more than one program to run concurrently. Achha. Concurrently in the sense, one after another, right? Whatever computer you are using right now, those are considered as the multitasking. Now, multitasking is a type of computer that means which allows you to do different kind of things. Let's say I am showing my PPT to you through my computer, right? Now, behind the computer, if I minimize that PPT, I can do other jobs, right? So that can be considered as the multitasking operating system. Now, multi-threading. Now, threading is an important concept or very powerful concept in the operating system. Now, thread, whatever you know as a thread, that is also here, it is means thread, right? How the thread works? Generally, what happened, just take an example. If try to do three things on your computer. One is write something on your Wi-Fi. Second one is listening some music. Third one is accessing the internet. Let's say you are doing these three things, and how the thread concept being implemented so that you can do these three things without any interruption. Okay. Now what happened? Let's say I am typing something, that means that one thread has been assigned by the operating system's kernel. Kernel means the head of the operating system. As like the head of the army is known as the kernel, similarly, an operating system has a kernel, and that kernel generates a thread for the Word document, whatever I am typing. Again, I am trying to listen to the music, so I open an MP3 player. Again, the kernel generates second type of thread for that. Now, third thing I am doing, the accessing the internet. Again, the kernel access the, or again the kernel generates the third kind of thread for the accessing of the internet. Now, what happened? The kernel gives the priority to the different tasks. Now, what do you mean by priority? Priority in the sense, the it gives the emphasis to the job what the user wants to do first, right? Now let's say I am typing, means the priority is one, that means high priority. Other two are second or third. Let's say I am typing something on Google, that means I am accessing internet, that means this is the first priority and other two are coming next to that. And the third thing, let's say I am listening, I am changing the song, that means I am accessing the MP3 player, that means it is the first priority again. Again, all those are the secondary priorities. So accordingly, thread generation is being done by the operating system's kernel in order to perform the multitasking job or multitasking thing on a single computer's operating system. Right? Okay. What is the benefit of the operating system? Now, before that, let me introduce something regarding the Windows operating system. Now, the world's first software company is the Windows. Sorry, Microsoft. The world's first operating software company is the Microsoft. But registered software company is Microsoft. But before the Microsoft, another company is being created, but it was not registered, is known as the Apple Corporation, right? But documentation wise, it is the Microsoft, which is the world's first software company. So that's the basic and requirement in order to come to first, who is complete all the documentation work first. So whatever thing you are seeing in the world, the font style, the font size, loss of character speaks in the Word or appearing in the Windows, all things have been created by the Apple Corporation founder Steve Jobs. And those are being created again by the Windows and registered first. That's why there are some conflict between the Apple and the Windows the previous day. Okay, forget that, but you need to know the world's first software company is the Microsoft. Now, operating system benefits. What are the benefits of the operating system? First one is it allows you to access the computer hardware in efficient manner. Okay. Second thing is for sharing, fairness, and security. That's right. Sharing in the sense, whenever you are connected over internet, you can share your file with different people. That does not mean sharing in the, that does not mean you can share the file through WhatsApp, through Facebook, or through any other mailing server. Not like that. Sharing in the sense, if five computers are there, then in the fifth computer, by sitting at the fifth computer, I can access the hard drive of the first computer. And that can be done by the using of the operating system. Okay. And technique is a little bit of different. Okay. Now, security. Security in the sense, currently, we can find almost all operating system comes with a firewall. Now, what do you mean by firewall? Firewall is a kind of gatekeeper to your operating system or to your computer. Now, what the gatekeeper do for you, that it allows the persons that you want to come in and do not allow who you do not want to come in. Now, that thing, your firewall does for you. How it do? The firewall is a basically a kind of software, right? Security software. Now, in that firewall software, you need to provide what type of email addresses, or what type of web addresses you want to access. Okay. Now, you just put those web addresses on the firewall and access those. And instead of those, what you have given in the firewall, except that whatever site you want to access, it do not allow you. So again, you need to go there and change the settings and allow it to do so, then it will allow. Now, some all websites are not safer, right? For the safety features, the firewall generally uses this criteria. Okay. Now, almost all versions of Windows coming under the firewall software. Now, second, third thing is abstract resources. Okay. Abstract resources means, let's say, I am using a software for developing a Java program, right? And the software's name may be the My Eclipse or NetBeans. Those are the two kinds of software, right? Now, whenever I am using this software must connect with the operating system. Now, how it will connect to the operating system? Just like at your home, you have a socket of electric and you put a plug over there and connect other devices. Similarly, the operating system generates a socket and allows whatever the application software you are installing to access through the operating system to your hardware component, right? So that it can be used. So again, that socket may be any kind of pin number. Pin number in the sense, for example, let's say 8085, 8003. Okay, these are the type of socket what can be used whenever you are installing a type of application software in your computer, right? Now, inter-process communication. Inter-process communication is a vast kind of thing. Basically, inter-process communication is preferable in the distributed operating system, right? Whatever operating system we discussed earlier, the distributed operating system is a little bit of different like that. And in distributed OS, the inter-process communication plays an important role. Without the inter-process communication, the distributed operating system will not work, right? That means a single software is being, single operating system being installed over the different computers. And by the inter-process communication, that means the communication being established with the five computers so as they know what is going on the first, second, third, fourth, and fifth computer. So as accordingly, they perform their job. That is called as the inter-process communication, right? Now, this is the basically what we need to know the Windows, okay? Windows is generally named after by the thought of the windows at your home. Okay, that means as windows at your home allows the bright sunlight, fresh air inside your room, as like the thought behind the nomenclature that the Windows software again do the same thing for your computer, right? Now, generally Windows is an operating system that has been developed by the Microsoft, right? It comes in two platforms. Number one is multitasking operating system. Number two is multi-user and multitasking operating system. Acha, multitasking operating system means it is a type of OS that is developed to do multiple tasks at the same time. That the software, the operating system what you are using right now, those are the single user multitasking operating system. That means the single user can sit in front of a computer and with that system he can do multiple tasks. Examples like Windows XP, 7, Windows 8 and so on. Now, multi-user multitasking operating system, that means the inter-process communication can be done by using this kind of operating system, right? That means multiple users can sit and multiple tasks can be performed, and for that multiple inter-processor communication should be done. So it is the operating system developed to multiple tasks of multiple users at the same time. Right? Examples NT 2000, Windows 2016, so on. These are the different kind of operating systems example of Windows that uses multi-user multitasking operating system. Right? Now these are the history geography of Windows operating system. I think if you search in that, you will find this thing. I don't think these are the most required thing, but yes, most and important thing is that MS-DOS, Microsoft DIX operating system, is the basic and the fundamental. This is called as the grandfather of Windows operating system. Without the grandfather, all other operating systems are dumb. They cannot do their work.
Microsoft DOS is the grandfather of all other operating systems. Now, basically, our Windows operating system is so much popular due to its best graphical user interface. Graphical user interface in the sense, you need not to write any kind of command whenever you are operating the system or operating system or a computer system. Okay. If you have used any type, you have used the MS-DOS, what happens? The MS-DOS allows you to remember the lots of commands to perform certain job. So nowadays, what Windows gives us, or the what Windows gives us, that instead of remembering lots of commands, you just use the GUI interface that we have provided. That the Windows provides to you. Now, instead you are writing something to access your hard disk to the MS-DOS, what you currently do, you just click upon the My Computer and access your hard disk. And access the files, whatever you can do, you can create very easily by a single mouse click. Now, similarly, our MS-DOS, any kind of operating system, basic building block is the MS-DOS. So, whenever you are clicking, in behind that, some instructions have been generated that we could not see them. We just click. Now, a single click again creates an instruction, and those instructions in behind the scene converted into the job. But we generally want to do. So instead of remembering lots of commands, a single click or a double click can do all sorts of job for us. Okay. So the first one is the basic, and now currently the up to Windows 10, whatever operating system of Windows you are using, behind the scene it is MS-DOS working. Now how you know? You just type the cmd command prompt of your operating system, will find. There you can go to the DOS operating system and you can type any kind of command over there and find how much difficult it is. Now, whenever it is introduced, the GUI interface based operating system, how it is that much of simple to use that. Okay. Now, coming to the My Computer. Okay. It is the basic gateway to your computer hard drive. Okay. Now, basically, our computer system, what I earlier told you, that a bunch of hardware and a type of software combined together gives our computer system. Right? Now, bunch of hardware, it may be the processor, maybe the RAM, maybe the hard disk, maybe the CD drive, okay, or maybe the graphics card. In order to assessing those, we require a software that is called the operating system. Now, that operating system through the My Computer GUI allows us to enter into the hard drive of your computer. Now, hard drive is a disk-like structure. Disk-like structure in the sense, a spherical kind of thing, and over that, a head, a laser-guided head is there, which is rotating at high speed in order to find out the memory location. So we are not going inside the details of the architecture, just coming to the computer, My Computer. So whenever you are double clicking the My Computer, you can find this kind of screen on your computer. Okay. And this screen gives you a different drives. Let's say C, D, E, F, what is the amount of drive you created, those drives can be shown to you. Again, some external devices have been connected, it is also being shown to you, just like your external hard disk, external pen drive, okay, any kind of mobile device is connected, those can be shown by using the My Computer GUI. Okay, now in the below you can see the icon of CD drive or DVD drive, whatever drive you have currently. Those are the isolated things, because whenever it is introduced in the pen drive, after that CD and DVD and floppy is being accelerated so many years ago, but currently generally people do not use CD or DVD drives very much frequently. Instead of that, they use a pen drive. And another thing is the use of pen drive has also some guidelines how to use that and how to remove that pen drive from your device. Okay. Now, I think you know that how to use that step removal of the pen drive. Okay, those things you know, because all of you using pen drive regularly. Okay, now, can somebody give me which version of Windows allows you to use a pen drive? Just if anybody knows, please write down in the comment box. If anybody knows which version of Windows allows, from the which version of Windows, it allows you to use the pen drive on your computer. If you know, very good. If you don't, if you know, then write me. If you don't know, then I will tell you, or else you can search. Okay. Now double clicking. Okay. Nobody knows? No reaction comes yet. Okay. Now, generally, whenever you are installing the operating system, it is decided we generally put it into drive C. Okay. Now, drive C is the place where we can store the operating system. Now, how to install the operating system, we will learn later after this. Okay. Now, D, E, F, all the drives you can store your files, your general purpose things you can store there. And if other things are your hard drive is full, then you can use external hard drive in order to store the different kind of things, right? Now, if I am buying, or your some of your friend, let's say he or she buys a new computer, and you try to know what is the configuration. Configuration in the sense, what is the amount of hard disk that computer have? What is the amount of RAM that computer have? What is the operating system type? What is the different hardware structure inside the computer? How will you know? How will you know that? Even though by opening the computer, you could not know the amount of RAM, you could not know the amount of hard drive. And it is very difficult. Your friend brings a new computer and he do not allow you to open it and see it. Just if he allows you to open the operating system, and by opening that, whatever you can do, you just do it. Now, by opening that operating system, how could you know the computer's details? Now, let me give you some demo. Okay. Now, look at this is my screen of my computer. I think it is not coming to your end. Okay, now this is my screen of a computer. Now this is my mic. Okay, this is my computer. Now what I do, I just right click here.
And go to this property and click that property. Look at this screen. This thing comes. Listen here. Okay, you can see here the Windows 7 Professional operating system being installed. Software 2009 Microsoft. The when it is being created and the copyright things all have been written there. Now coming to the system, here processor type Intel R Core TM i5 CPU. Okay. Now this is M54 at the rate 2.53 gigahertz. Right? What is this kind of thing? 2.53 gigahertz. Gigahertz is the frequency of your CPU. That means what is the speed of the computer? That can be decided by this figure, right? The amount of figure that much of high means that much of speed of your computer you can access, right? Okay. Installed memory RAM is 4 GB, and among that 2.43 GB is usable. And system type, that means my operating system is 32-bit operating system. Pen or hard drive not enabled. Now this is the name of my computer, and lots of things are the product key of the things, lots of things are available here. Then you can find all sorts of hardware and software things that are being installed. You need to know, you can find it. But here you could not find what is the amount of hard drive. Now hard drive kind of thing you can find whenever you are just clicking the my computer, and again look at this thing. Let it come to your screen, then I will show you. Okay. Now I have C, E, and F drive. Okay. Now here you can below that you have written that 33.4 GB of free of 97.5 GB. Okay. Now total is 97.5, here 97.5 and 102 GB. Now almost I have 100, 200, 300. Almost 300 GB of hard drive associated with my computer, right? So this is the thing, how could you know? And this is the, listen here, the DVD writer and the CD writer. Two things have been given there, and you can easily find out what are the things associated with the computer. with the help of a single click. No need to go anywhere else or no need to ask some person that please give me the details or please give me the configuration of the computer, right? Now coming to the presentation section. Okay. Now, generally what happens, my computer is the gateway to the hard drive. Whatever you have stored in your hard drive, that can be accessed by using the my computer, right? Now, again, double clicking the drive, you can go inside that. I think you know that. I need not to describe that. Again, double clicking. Look at this. Let me show you the demo. Okay. Now here you can find out. Okay. Now organize. In the organize section, you have lots of things. It has been something has been highlighted. Highlighted means it can work right now, and those are not highlighted will not work now. Now system property, what we previously moved by clicking of the my computer, right click and go to the properties, right? That is the system property. Okay. Now uninstall or change a program. That is very important, right? Whatever program I have in my computer. Okay. Now try to understand the difference between install and load. Okay. Install, load and store. Install means a proper guidance to the operating system being given so as to identify the particular kind of program. Okay. Installation. Load in the sense the particular, let's say you are software being loaded. That means it is only put inside the hard disk, right? It is not being used. After installing that software, only that can be used. Without installing that software, you cannot use that. Now let's say something what I do not require and which is being installed by me and the work has been done. I do not require that software. It is unnecessarily capturing my hard drive. So what I do, I just clicking upon that particular software. Let's say actually I do not remove any kind of software installed in my computer. Any kind of, let's say this is the text file, right? Now uninstall, it starts uninstalling, right? Look, the uninstall process starts. Just I cancel it, so I do not want to remove my text file, so I cancel it so that it will not uninstall. Okay, look at that. The text file 5 is intact as usual, right? This gives the difference. And the repair section, what happened, guys? Now, the updated version of every software is coming, right? Now, the if we do not connect our computers over internet for a longer period of time, and after that we connect, the computer automatically starts updating those software. And during the updation, some files have been missing, right? Whenever some file has been missing, the software will not work properly. Now what we do, we just repair that. Repair in the sense, maybe look at that. By clicking on OK, it allows you what kind of software repairing you need to perform. Okay. Now it reparation will be done and the software being used again again by you, right? So here you can use resources, you can browse and where the software being there, then you can access that software, again you can repair that software, right? So I close that. I think you understand. Okay, now press the back button. Now map network devices. This is the network devices for the the internet users. Now if some device, for example router or maybe the modem, all sorts of things, if you have connected to your device, it allows you. Which is the browser, sorry, the router may must have some software. Now you install that software, and if it is not coming, now this is that kind of troubleshoot. Now which drive you need to find out which drive that software is being installed or you want to install. Now you find that, then the browse, then network, go to. I don't have any kind of software, that's why it is frozen, no discovery. Okay, so you find that and again select that and again troubleshoot it, right? Now open control panel. Okay, now here the control panel allows all kind of stuff: system and security, network and internet, hardware and sound, programs, and below that lots of things has been installed. That means this is the main icon. Under that you can perform lot this kind of job under that, right? Now let's say I'm clicking the system and security. Under system and security, these are the things you can find out. Now listen, look at here, I have Windows Firewall, inbuilt Windows Firewall, right? Now what I told you earlier, it given to me, right? Okay, whatever you want to change here, you can change here. The control panel allows you to do so. And program under the install and uninstall. Okay, now you click upon that. Look, all sorts of program, previously what we have seen, same thing from here, and you can do all sorts of things here, right? And this is the control panel is a very 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 powerful part of the Windows. Okay, now this is my C drive. What are the installed software I have? Those can be shown here. Okay, and next thing, what are the files I have been stored? That can be stored here, and I can access that. Okay, now another file I am opening here. These are the things. Okay, just double clicking upon any drive, you can move on that, right? Now this is a simple demo you can find out. And if you do not know anything, just you put your mouse pointer for some time, something has been written over there, and you can see what is that and why it is being stored. And the left side column, you can find lots of things. That is the desktop, that is the recent place. Recent place, what means? Let's say, in the 1 hour ago, you just download a particular file, and that file is placed here, recently whatever you are doing. And also, downloads, it gives you all sorts of things, whatever you are downloading earlier. Now this is my download folder, which have lots of things. Okay, lots of things have been there. Okay, so moving to the fast part. And another important thing what I am trying to tell you, you find that among all the system, you know, the Windows operating system, basically generally what we know, two types of operating system basically we know. One is your Windows operating system, another one is your Apple Corporation's iOS. And third thing, if you know or don't know, I think you know, that is the Linux operating system. Among that, most attacks are upon the Windows system, right? Now, why that happened? Why all the attackers attack at the Windows operating system? Instead of Windows, others are being safe. You can find the recent track that all the Windows system being attacked, not other system. And again, if Windows being attacked, then why could not we use the other operating systems in order to save ourselves? That is also a question, right? Now question is that the graphical user interface designing of the Windows is much more simpler, number one. Now number two, by GUI you can say that Windows has the same graphical user interface as like the iOS. So why could not we use the iOS? Reason because iOS is a little bit costly than the Windows, right? Now, if you buy a laptop in 50,000 of a Windows system, now same kind of facility you could try to buy for the iOS, maybe it will cost around 1 lakh or more than that, right? So that is the main difference, pricing difference, okay? Now, same thing can be considered as the Linux. Sir, why could not we use Linux? So basically, Linux is an operating system. It uses the command prompt. That means you need to remember lots of commands. And people who are doing their jobs regularly, they do not try to expense their time or expense their knowledge in order to remembering the commands, instead remembering their jobs, right? So they are not very much user friendly, right? So that's why maximum people are using Windows operating system. And the basic disadvantages of Windows, whatever software you try to install, that have an extension name as .exe, right? .exe. Now that is a very, very, very loose extension name. You heard currently that any kind of link come to your computer, do not click that if it is suspicious. That means whenever you are clicking that link, an exe file automatically installed. That means Windows allows that exe file. Because if it is exe file, that means executable. Windows know that yes, it is executable. This is being automatically executed to your computer, and the internet user who is sitting remotely can access your computer through that software, but he sent by that link. So do not click upon any kind of suspicious link whenever you are using your Windows operating system. So that is an important thing you need to know. And all sorts of new channel and all sorts of security personnel, they are also giving this advice. Okay. Now these things I have discussed. Now coming to the how to create a folder. Okay. Instead of reading the site, let's have a particular kind of demo. And this is my desktop, right? Okay. This is my desktop. Now, for creating a folder, I click right click on my desktop. Whenever place you do same thing, the process is same, but you need to move, you need to create a folder whichever place you can go there. Right click there, then come to the new option. Okay, by clicking of the new option here, the first comes the folder. Now click that folder, then you can have the new folder for code is coming here, and it is being selected. Look at that, it is being selected. Okay. Now, if I click outside, then it is named automatically being suggested by the operating system, because I have previously three new folders. This is the third one, this is the second one, and maybe somewhere else a new folder, another new folder may be there. Okay, here is the new folder. New folder 1, new folder 2, new folder 3, and this is currently created new folder 4. Now, what I want to name, just right click upon that, let's say rename of the folder, right click upon that. Now, go to this rename option. Right click, then go to the rename option, bottom second, the rename option is there. And click that rename option, then it again select. Okay, now you can put any kind of name. Let's say I give the name ABC, the name of the folder. Now press enter. Now the folder has been renamed as ABC, right? Now what I do, I just want to delete it. Just right click here. Now last third option is the delete. Now put upon that delete. Okay? Are you sure you want to move this folder to recycle bin? That means whenever I clicking upon the yes, it moves to the recycle bin of my computer. Now what I do? I just go to the recycle bin. Here you can see, this is the thing. ABC folder is there. So again from the recycle bin, I could do two things. I can restore it. If it is by mistakenly deleted, I can restore it and it will go to the same place where it has been deleted, or I can delete it from permanent. So if I put it here delete, then it automatically deleted the particular folder. If I restore it, look at, if I pressing the restore, what happened? The icon is moved here, from here to this place. Look at this. Okay, this is the thing. Now another thing you can do, how could I hide this? Now again right click it and come to the properties. Okay, in the properties you can see attributes. At the bottom you have three attributes. There you can have another checkbox, hide. Clicking upon that, apply. Okay, this is the hide kind of thing. Now though this is my computer, so it is it could not hide the folder from me. Whenever I reset it, this folder will be hidden, right? So what I do, I just again show it to others. So apply. Okay, look at the low visibility comes to the solid visibility. Okay, now for the delete, right click, delete, yes, again right click on the recycle bin, open, and again I find this, and again here I have to delete it, yes, and the folder has been deleted, right? How to rename? I give you the idea of renaming of the file, deleting, how to delete, copy. Okay, for the copy something, you just do one thing. Again, look at the same, go to the my computer, another folder, so that I can give you a simple demo how to copy a folder from one place to another place. Right? Let's say I have here the lesson plan 2016 EVE, even semester. Let's say I am trying to copy it. Copy. And let's say I try to put it in the workspace. Okay, here I want to put it. Right click, paste. Where is the paste? Here. This is the paste. Okay. Copy paste allows you to create another copy of that file. That means this file is intact here. Also, another copy is being stored here also. In two places, two copies are there. But what I do, if I cut here, cut, and again try to put that in workspace one and paste here, what happened? Now that particular, the origin place do not have that file. Look at this. Where I put 16 again. Yes. There are two things are there. Cut. If I put here, paste. Listen. Put it in the original place where the file is, did not appear here. Right? The thing is being done like this. The small thing I think you know. Okay. And one specific thing you need to know. Let's say my workspace contains this file name. Okay, lesson plan 2016 event. Now just what I do, I just copy it and again create a new folder and try to rename it as same name. Control V. It will not allow you. Okay. Why it allowed me? Because the type of file is different. Because it is a folder, it is a Word file. Okay. Now let's see same kind of another folder I am creating. And again give the same name. Listen. This thing again happened. That same name is being there already in the folder. So would you want to replace it or would you want to delete it or not? So it asks you. Which one you do? So I know. So let's see, it is new folder. So just what I do, I just delete that. Okay. Now, coming to the most important part of the Windows, that is the how to install a window. Now, first you need to find out a Windows CD, Windows 7 CD, because your syllabus contains Windows 7 operating system. So that's why I am giving the details regarding Windows 7. Now, first you need to find out a Windows 7 CD. Enter your computer's BIOS. What do you mean by BIOS? BIOS means basic input and output system, right? Now, whenever you are entering, first you need to do turn off your computer that you want to install Windows. Then, by again reset, actually turn off, that is not turn off, reset your computer. And after resetting, during the reset process, you can press this keys, whichever keys given here in the blue color of your keyboard. Now you enter to the BIOS of your computer. Okay, and after that, this thing will appear on your screen. This kind of screen you will find out. This is the first step, right? Now, look at here, the boot option is there. Now you go to the boot. Now select the CD-ROM drive as the first boot drive of your computer. Now for the booting, you just select the CD drive. Here all the input, if you are entering your Windows 7 to your pen drive, now you have to select your USB. If it is a CD drive, you have to select it a CD drive, right? Now step 2 is complete. Now step 3, ask you exist saving the change. Now previously you have an operating system, now or you may not have, so that have already been saved something inside your computer. So it asks you exist saving change. Yes, exist saving change. I want to change my settings. Now after that, it will ask in the step 4, you will find this kind of windows. Save configuration change and exit now. Now you have installed the software and installed the CD. Now it asks you, basically it means that the computer will access that CD for the configuration change and exit now. Configuration change, for the changing of the configuration, you just give the computer permission and he starts doing that. Now what do you do in the step 5? Shut off your computer. Enter the turn off of your computer by choosing the shutdown operation in the computer's operating system, or hold the power button until the computer is in power off. No. If you are try to power off, again you need to power off your computer here. Okay. If it is not power off, then you need to press your on or off button for a long period of time. Now again, the computer starts rebooting. And during that rebooting, it starts reading your CD drive, whatever you have installed. Now this is this screen will appear in the step 6 during the loading of the Windows. Now this step 7 gives you the different language type or which type of here, something that installation process have the basic thing. Just click upon the next. Now after that you are the installer now. Now put that put click upon that install now. Now after the install now you have to sign the agreement. Agreement means I accept that. All of you have come across this kind of thing. I think so. Okay. Now upon clicking that, now coming to the step 10. Okay. Okay. Here it asks you two things. Either you want to upgrade or either you want to custom advanced. Okay. Now among those, it's up to you which kind of setting you want to. Basically, what we do, we choose the second option. Okay, advanced one for the installation, new installation. Now it is come to the which disk you want to put your operating system. Now you choose the disk, which type of disk you want to decide your operating system. Now again, press the next button. Now it starts doing the thing automatically for you. Step 12 is like that. After that, step 13 is that. With the after installation, the screen is appearing like this. Now you can find it. Your Windows 7 screen is like this. Okay. Now this is the installation process of the Windows. Okay. Now one important thing I want to share among you, that if my computer is slower, let's say my computer is being slower, so what should I do? Should I reinstall the software? Or should I do anything, any short-term thing so that my computer will be a little bit faster? Now, reinstalling the software gives you lots of hazard. Hazard in the sense, if only you format your drive, C drive, then it's okay. Now, if you want to format your whole computer, it's not okay. All of your files have been deleted. Now, in order to protect your file, you need to do one thing, but now you just copy those important files of your computer and save it in the another drive. Again, you reinstall the software. That can be done. But any other options for speeding up my computer? Yes, you can do other options. What can I do? The first option is go to the start button. Please try to remember that if you face this kind of problem, do this, your computer is a little bit of speeder than the previous time. Okay. So let the screen come out. I think the screen is not coming up. Okay. Now go to the start button, and the start button. Type run okay. Is it my screen is visible? No, previous okay. Yes, yes, it is coming right now. It is coming. Okay. I can start from the starting. Go to the start button. Here in the search space, you try run run and press enter. This will come. Okay, and in the box you write temp, temp, that is a temporary file. Now what is that temporary file? Try to understand, whenever Windows is performing any task or creating any file, the temporary file has been created by the RAM in order to access it faster. Okay, in order to access it faster, in the sense your memory you have read, your cache memory and the primary memory, just like your cache and your RAM, are the two things which are being part of speeding of your computer. Right. Now for that, it generally creates a temporary file in order to access the file very quickly. So whatever type you are clicking, that type of that amount of temporary file has been created. So I type here to access that temporary file, I just type here temp, now press OK. Now look at this. The amount of temporary file my computer has been created is this much amount. Listen, the space is very less or negligible, not 0 KB or 93 KB or 2000 something KB. In terms of KB, this will appear in terms of KB. But what happens if the number of temporary files increases in your computer CPU confuses which temporary file it wants to access the particular main file. So number of temporary file means number of confusion is more, and number of confusion is more means number time spending is more. So what I do, I just select it, just pressing Control A, all files have been selected. Now I delete it, just delete. I have 73 items to recycle in. Yes, I delete it. Okay, those have been deleted, those are not allowed to delete, that will be stay here, right? This has been stayed. So again, what I do, I just move to the recycle bin. Same thing come to the recycle bin. So again, I select all the things, again I delete it from the recycle bin also. Now after recycle bin, you can find your computer a little bit of faster. Right. Now another thing you can do also, go to the My Computer. Any kind of drive you want to, generally what happens, whenever you are placing or storing any kind of file or any folder, it do not store in serial manner, right? Serial manner means your, for example, let's say your memory has a number, and the number, let's say, starts from 0 to 100. Okay. Now you start storing a particular type of movie on my D drive or E drive, whatever drive you want to store. Now what it do, it just takes that movie and stores in memory address number 51. Next time it can store memory address number 1. Next time it can store memory address number 100. So anonymously it puts that thing in any address. So what can you do? Now whenever I am clicking searching that, whenever I am clicking means the CPU searches for me. Now if the search space is less, then it will take less time. If search space is more, it will take more time. So what happened? We need to reduce the search space. Now how could we reduce the search space? Now if 3 files have been stored in one location, 51 location and 100 location, can I store that in 0, 1, 2 or 0, 5, 6? That means in a very little bit different manner. Can I store it? Yes, I can do that. How could I do that? I just click upon this. Okay, why don't it option is not showing to me? Defragment another option will come. How come it comes? I do not know. There another option will come as a defragment. Okay. Format, copy, create, upload, rename property. It is not coming right now. I think I have done it, that's why it may not come here. Let's say computer, my computer. You can know it is not coming also here also. So here another option will come. You will find a defragment, right? So I do not have that option. So if anybody's computer have this kind of option, just click upon that and start defragmenting your drive. Okay. Now it will automatically do the same thing what you try to do. In serially fashion, it will store the things. Okay. No, it don't allow me to do so. Okay. So this is another option you can do. Compress, restore, trigger session, create new structure, genome properties. Okay. Further about the thing, defragmentation option definitely comes here, but I think I have some problem in my computer, that's why it is not coming. So you can try on your own computer, the defragment will come. Now click upon that defragment and just click the next, and it will automatically take some time. 5 to 10 minutes it will take, and it will automatically serially fashionably store your files. Right? And after that you can find your computer is little bit of slow. Now these are the two techniques that can enlarge or enhance the speed of your computer, and basically this is the basic things you need to know regarding the Windows operating system. And the next class we will discuss about the Linux operating system, which is basically GUI based as well as the command prompt. So you can find the Linux operating system in network companies who have been providing the network services, and in the railway ticket platform, ticket counter, they are using basically the Linux operating system in order to save their computer for the hacking, right? So with this I conclude today's class. Now I am requesting ma'am.
Thank you so very much, sir. Such a brief description with the practical hands-on session, and within a small limited period of time, that is a very good thing for our learners to hear you, to able to hear you. And I hope almost all of the doubt regarding Windows as well as your operating system and its type, that will be cleared out by our student. Now I would like to request the learners, if they have still any doubt, they can ask directly, or they will write it in the chat box.
I'll be happy to answer you, guys. Any question comes to your mind, please ask. And don't think that it may be silly, somebody will laugh at me. Don't think that. Nothing is silly, nothing is very big.
I hope, sir, the session is so much transparent. That's why I don't think there will be any doubt from any learners, because you have covered the tip to bit everything regarding the part of Windows, how to use the system in Windows operating system and how to manage it. I also like to request the learners to please go through your SLMs, and if there will be any doubt still there, then you can also ask in the next class as well. So I hope there would not be any doubt more. And once again, thank you so much, sir, for your precious time and for your such effort of describing the thing with a practical hands-on session. Thank you so much once again. And with this, I am also thanking Bhavesh sir and Himadri sir. And last but not the least, I am thanking all the learners for their support. We hope we will continue the same spirit of learning teaching in the next class also, in the next session also. With this, I am winding up the session. Thank you so much, sir, once again. And thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you.
Have a good day, all.
Thank you, madam.